Welcome to the Fast Leader Podcast, where we uncover the leadership life hacks that help you to experience breakout performance faster and rocket to success. And now, here's your host, customer and employee engagement expert, and certified emotional intelligence practitioner, Jim Rimbaugh.
Call Center Coach develops and unites the next generation of call center leaders. Through our e-learning and community, individuals gain knowledge and skills in the six core competencies that is the blueprint that develops high-performing call center leaders. Successful supervisors do not just happen. So go to callcentercoach.com to learn more about enrollment and download your copy of the Supervisor Success Path ebook now. Okay, Fast Leader Legion, today I'm excited because today I get to talk to somebody who hopefully is going to really help me and you about putting some things together that will help our business move forward faster and really impact the customer. Howard Partridge grew up in L.A., that's Lower Alabama, Mobile, Alabama to be exact. He was the fifth of seven kids. They were all on welfare and crammed in a little 600-square-foot shack. The roof on that house was so bad that when it rained, they had to get out the pots and pans to catch the leaks. At a young age, he could be found going to the beach and riding his bike. At the age of 18, he got into a fight with his stepdad and got kicked out of the house. He had no money, and a friend helped him scrape up enough money for a Greyhound bus ticket to Houston. His real dad, who he had only met twice in his entire life, lived there. To make a living, he worked in a grocery store, was a painter's helper, washed dishes, and waited tables. After working as a waiter in several restaurants, he worked his way up to working in high-end restaurants. After getting married, he started his first business out of the trunk of his car with $3,000 of their wedding money. And they are still married today, because over the last 30 years, he has built that wedding money into a multi-million dollar enterprise. He has owned 9 businesses altogether and currently owns 4. Howard is the president of Phenomenal Products, Inc. He's an international business coach with coaching members in over 100 industries in 9 countries. He's the author of The Power of Community and 6 other books, a TEDx speaker, the exclusive business coach for Ziegler Corporation, and first Ziegler Legacy Trainer in the world, the first founding member of the John Maxwell team, and a Master Trainer DISC certified human behavior expert. He has led hundreds of seminars, webinars, workshops, and holds his own live multi-day events, which have featured some of America's top trainers, including John Maxwell, Michael Gerber, Bob Berg, Dr. Joseph Michelli, Darren Hardy, Dr. Robert Rome, and American legend Zig Ziglar. Howard and his wife Denise have been married for 34 years and live in Houston, Texas mostly, and part-time in Destin, Florida. They have one son, Christian, who is 25. Howard Partridge, are you ready to help us get over the hump?
Absolutely.
Well, I'm glad you're here. Now, I've given my legion a little bit about you, but can you share what your current passion is so that we can get to know you even better?
My current passion is developing people, as simple as that, whether that is one of my 40 team members or the handful of people that work directly with me, especially the younger ones. I love helping them develop, and I love to see life change happen with our coaching members. We've got almost 400 coaching members in 9 different countries, and I lead 273 trainers in 19 different countries. So to see people have breakthroughs, that's what gets me up every day today.
You know, what I found really interesting is I started, you know, learning more and more about you and really diving into the book, The Power of Community, is it seems like, you know, first you've kind of had this, you know, business focus, running a good business and all the systems and processes and everything around that. And then you've kind of, I don't know if you'd say it's gained the wisdom or really found the passion you can actually allude it to, but you really started getting to the whole people component, and that has really been the base of everything else.
Absolutely. Just a quick snapshot is I started my business and I was really great at customer service because, as you and I talked before, I came from high-end restaurants where the service experience was everything. And it's true that the experience that your company delivers is what's going to set you apart from the competition. But what happens to get there is really interesting. My epiphany came. I was a slave to my business, worked 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And every time I traveled, loved to travel, I was, it seemed like I was always on the phone talking to customers or employees back home. And I read a book called The E-Myth Revisited by Michael Gerber, and it changed my life. I saw that I could have a turnkey business, so I started building systems in my business. Well, I realized that there were a couple more components that needed to take place. One of them was personal development. I got involved with Ziglar. I ended up becoming great friends with Michael Gerber, by the way, and mentored by him. And I'm jumping around my story a little bit, but I got involved with Ziglar because I realized that a personal growth was so important. The person that you become, because everything flows out from that. And then I learned about leadership, and everything rises and falls on leadership. And so it's really all about the relationships through and through. So I came to the conclusion that we need to grow personally. We need to have systems in our business so that things don't have to be recreated and everybody knows what to do. And then we need to develop ourselves as leaders. We need to develop our team so that they can grow personally and they can grow as leaders. Those are our future leaders. And then, of course, the whole idea of community, of having creating a sense of community in your company as well as around yourself as a leader. Yeah. And so those are really five values that I have.
Well, and for me, when I started, you know, initially looked at community, I probably had a different lens. And then when I started getting into the book, it was like kind of opened up my mind and my eyes to where you're talking about, you know, the community that we create that is a more of a personal community, not a social community like, you right. know, we get inundated with, you know, these days. But, you know, it was definitely of a more of an intimate type of focus and connection. And you talk about really three keys to having a community that is strong. You talk about support, encouragement, accountability, and then you talk about six steps to building that community. You talk about valuing or value true community, pursue champion connections, inspire emotional trust, practice gift exchange. And I want to dig into that one a little bit more. When I started getting into that, it really was a different perspective that I wasn't necessarily interpreting when I first read it. And then invite open-hearted encounters, and then building growth pods. So when you start talking about these six steps of building that community, how did that evolve or come out?
Well, it actually happened about 25 years ago, and it happened through church, even though this conversation is not going to be about church or religion. And by the way, the community in this sense is not a neighborhood, not a nationality, but a group of people that operate by the same vision, the same values. And I open up the book with the quote that every human being has a longing for belonging. We all want to feel loved. We all want to feel valued. We all want to feel like our life matters. Yet 70% of American workers still are disengaged. 18% of those workers are actively disengaged. And I have had this sense for a long time, and studying leadership for 25 years, I've had this sense that creating a sense of community in your company is a good idea. And it just took me a few years to finally come to the place where I was ready to outline a solution to create the steps. And I actually worked with a consultant for 2 years, but I've known about this for 25 years. And what happened was I would go to church every Sunday, and the message was good. It was, you know, one person to many, which is important to inspire people and maybe to even instruct or to teach. But then on Tuesday night, we had a small group, a home group. And this is where the real action was. This is where real ministry happened. This was where, you know, one, each person had a gift, speaking of gifts, and one had a song, one was a teacher, and people were helping each other and serving each other and involved in one another's lives. And real change was happening in those human beings. And I started finding out about the Cell Church movement, which is organizing a church around what are called cell groups, and realized that this was a total movement. And I spent several years in that movement. And then I started applying it to my business. And I would, instead of having a traditional staff meeting where one person's in front of the room and does a meeting, which typically is not very good, I would get our folks in a circle and let them share. Because the thing is that most employees, the reason that they're frustrated is they don't feel heard. And the owner or the business, the manager, the business owner, the leader, doesn't want to hear from them because then they might have to change what their agenda is. And so my mentor taught me that vision plus vision equals division. And eventually different agendas are going to develop and there's going to be this struggle. So let's just have an open conversation about the vision and about the value. So a community is any group of people that are pursuing the same vision and living by the same set of values. Doesn't mean that we're going to, you know, agree on everything. We might like, you know, different movies. We might have different values about different areas of life. But when you create the vision for your company, which in my mind, I call it MVP, includes your mission, what you do every day, your values, who you're going to be and how you're going to act, and your purpose, why you exist, I call it MVP, then everybody can get around that and they can decide, is this company the company that I want to be associated with? Is this the vision that I want to pursue? Will it add meaning to my own life? And are these the values that I'm willing to live by?
I think we're starting to see that more and more where people are focusing in on fit more yeah. than, you know, they are as far as, you know, background, experience, skill set. I mean, if people have a core foundation and exposure to, you know, a particular, you know, area, you know, and they're teachable, you know, yeah. and that MVP, you know, is a fit. I mean, that's really where we should be focusing. And I think you cover that as far as building, you know, proper teams and the pods and all that. So there, that one section, that step, is called that practice of gift exchange. And one, there was one area in there that you talked about helping your team focus, to me, that I think was an excellent framework when you really start getting to the point where you have that deeper relationship and helping, you know, people kind of, you know, find, you know, some of their own purpose. And you talk about seven core areas of life, mm-hmm. and they're personal, financial, career, family, physical, mental, and spiritual. Now, I have to say that there's probably some church basis in that as well, but where did some of that come from?
Well, you bet. Well, in the book, since the book is published by McGraw-Hill and is going to all over the world, when, as you notice in the book, I left that last one. I said, that's really up to your culture. Obviously, you know, I have my own faith that probably comes through in all of my books, including this one. Certainly some of them that I publish with smaller publishers. But the idea here is Mr. Zig Ziglar, who was my mentor, he's my hero, the late Zig Ziglar. And I work very closely with the company and help really run the company. His company, and his favorite quote until the day he passed away in November of 2012 is, you can have everything in life you want if you just help enough other people get what it is that they want. And I found that that's leadership, that leadership, all of business and all of life is about relationships. And I think the challenge is today is that we're focused so much on skill sets and we're too afraid to get close to people. It doesn't mean that you need to have a, you know, super close personal relationship. It doesn't mean that you need to be inappropriate. But, you know, Mr. Ziglar also said that the old saying that nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. And Mr. Ziglar added to that about them. Nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care about them. Even people like Kevin Turner, who was the chief operating officer at Microsoft, everybody that came onto his team, he would, on his personal team, he would have them do a presentation that I think was like 30 minutes on called Who Am I? And they would share about their life. And, you know, we forget that humans are they're not just resources, that we're living, breathing. If it's true, and I always get the nod when I say this, if it's true that every human being has a longing for belonging, they want to feel loved, they want to feel accepted, they want to have meaning to their life, they want to know that their life matters. And if it's true that what Jim Collins says is that meaningful work equals a meaningful life, then we've got to figure out how to create some kind of meaning. And the way that I have seen it be successful is that when you join this community, you'll not only grow professionally, but you'll grow personally. And if you help people personally, if you help them reach their goals, again, back to this quote, back to this truth, you as a leader, you as a business owner, you as a manager can have everything in life you want if you just help enough other people get what it is that they want. So the three keys are support, encouragement, and accountability. So if we take those seven areas of life that you mentioned and we approach life in such a way that we ask our team members when they come on board, people who are on our team, you know, tell me about your goals. What are some of the things that you want to accomplish personally? I don't need to know all the personal details of your life. That's totally up to you how much you want to share or not share. And, but the thing is that we want to provide resources. Support is helping other people have the things that they want to have. Everyone wants to have a better life. If I can help someone reach a goal, if I can help someone learn a skill, if I can help someone provide a contact or a book or a resource or a podcast or a download or something, it's just a demonstration that I care about them. And, you know, even if they want to go do something like run a marathon or write a book or something like this, so many managers, so many business owners are afraid that, well, if they write this book and become successful, they'll leave. Well, good, because you help them reach their goal. And then you're going to have the Lou Holtz syndrome. Lou Holtz syndrome was, you know, a reporter asked, hey, you winning all these titles and all your assistant coaches are moving on to head coaching jobs. Isn't that a problem for you? He said, quite the contrary. He said, you ought to see all the assistant coaching applications that we have. We got the best in the world that want to come to work for me because they know it's the fastest way to success. So the first key of creating this sense of community, this sense of belonging, this sense of total engagement is to support people, help them have the things that they want to have. Everybody wants to have, Mr. Ziegler used to say, everybody wants to be happy. You can't help, you can't make anybody happy, but you can create an environment that, that where they can, if they choose to be happy, they can. You can help someone be unhappy, I guess. Everybody wants to be happy, healthy, reasonably prosperous. They want to have friends. They want to have peace of mind. They want to have good family relationships. They want to be secure. They want to have hope for the future. And as Simon Sinek said, we can create the environment for change. The second key in building a sense of community is encouragement. And that is helping people do the things that they want to do. Maybe they're afraid to write that book. Maybe they're afraid to take that promotion. Maybe they're afraid to speak in public. Maybe they're afraid. In fact, I've got one who works for me who, when I hired her, I have a habit of people who come on my team. First of all, talking about gift exchange, we have to look at their personality profile and see and fit that personality profile with that behavior style with the right position, because you can't have a reserved, task-oriented person out there on the front lines, you know, doing the promotion and on stage in front of people. And at the same time, you can't have that person who is the entertainer locked up in a closet doing accounting, right? So when you get that piece of it right, and that's why the DISC profiles that we recommend are so important. Then we can have a conversation during the interview process. So what do you like to do? You know, what's your favorite thing to do? What was your favorite thing to do at your last job? You keep that conversation going even after they work for you. And so I have one that said, you know, I don't want to do sales and I don't want to be in front of the room. Now with a training business, then those are two components that are very important. It's like, I can live with that because I've got a lot of admin stuff to do. Well, guess what she does now? She does sales and she gets in front of the room. She's getting better at that. And the reason is because of encouragement. And she's got the gift. She's incredible in both respects. And so she just needed to be encouraged. So encouragement is giving people the fuel, helping them do the things that maybe they're afraid to do, doing the things that they want to do. And when you do this, this is the way that it works is support has two steps underneath it, which is to value people. When you don't value people, you devalue people. and show them that you value them. And the way that you show them that you value them is by helping them, right? And then two is serving them. That's called servant leadership. There's a lot out there on servant leadership. And again, the idea is if I demonstrate to you that I'm a leader by serving you, not doing your job for you, not holding you accountable, but I'm here to help you. I want you to be successful. And you would think the way that some business owners and managers and leaders treat people, you would think that they don't want them to be successful. They criticize them, they condemn them, they complain. And those are three things that Mr. Dale Carnegie said, that's the first thing. If you want to win friends and influence people, don't criticize, condemn, or complain. Smile, for crying out loud. That was, I think, it's number two. He had 31 principles. And so once you support people, they'll begin to trust you a little bit more, and then you can encourage them. No one wants encouragement from someone that they don't know is for them, right? That, you know, if you don't value, I mean, why do I want you to encourage me? So then you can move to the next two steps, and that you mentioned, inspire emotional trust and to practice gift exchange. So in this, these two steps that are building on the first two, is you show them that you care and you develop them. You help them develop themselves. So we provide all sorts of goals training, Ziegler training, DISC training, and different things like that, so that they can develop the gifts that they already have. So if I already have a gift of, say, writing or speaking or editing or organization or whatever, I can put you through training and help you develop yourself. And by showing you that I care about you as a human being, that's going to create this relationship of trust. I did a huge study on the Leadership Challenge series, and there's several books, and this is a 40-year study. And the thing is that at the end of the day, leadership is a relationship. It's all about trust. It's all about credibility. If you don't have trust with people, they're not going to open up to you. They're not going to give you the feedback that you need. They're not going to give you the information that you need. So when you support people and you encourage them, now you've built a really good foundation for having the right kind of accountability. See, what managers and business owners do is, you know, do your job. You know, I pay you. It's so many times it's negative and there's no relationship there. Sure, I understand I got to do my job, but where's the relationship here? And the idea is that you're going to get more accountability when there is that trust, when there is that relationship. And accountability is helping people become the person that they want to be. So Mr. Ziegler taught that you have to be before you can do, and you have to do before you can have. If people are struggling, there's something inside of them. There's something that they some value, some thought that they've, some belief that they've adopted about themselves that causes them to do or not do the things that that they do or don't do. So it opens up a tremendous opportunity, and it can't be taken lightly, and it can't be forced. And some leaders may not be willing to go there.
Well, but, in the book, you call it welcomed accountability. And I really like the way that you address that.
Because
it's really what you're talking about. I mean, it's the difference between having the command and control and the other is you talked about being, you know, care and coach.
Yeah. So the command and control model, you might get a lot done, but you're going to have a lot of turnover. People aren't going to want to come to work. It's going to be a negative environment. And when you care and coach and people want to be their best because you've supported them, encouraged them, accountability, that welcomed accountability becomes, now they look at you as a coach. They look at you as a mentor. And that's the final two steps, is that there's phenomenal leaders love others to the point where they're willing to have these open heart encounters, is what I call them, where someone has a breakthrough personally. And they want to share that with you because you have guided them, you have helped them, you've coached them. And then that's the final one, is that a leader is a coach. And you look at your role as a business owner, as a leader, as a manager, is you have your team, you have your players. It's your job to coach them and direct them. And coaching is more about asking questions than it is telling people what to do, right? And so that's what accountability is. And when you enter into that level of relationship with people, it's amazing. I had one of those kinds of conversations with my 35-year-old employee this morning. He's been with me since he was 17 years old, and he's learned all this stuff as we've gone along. The technical skills, he's amazing. His heart is amazing. And we have a person on one of our teams in one of my companies who is about to lose a daughter to cancer. And he's close to this guy, and he was just telling me, he said, I don't know what to say to him. And I told my, I told Santiago, I said, Santi, you know, you, I'm 57. And I said, you know, you are the fix it guy. He's like Superman. He can do anything. And, you like to come in and fix things, and you like to share with people, hey, think about it this way, or think about it this way. You're facing this for the very first time in your life. You can't expect to know the answer. But who did he come to when he needed to talk this over? His boss. And he's really my best friend in the whole world outside of my wife. So it's that kind of relationship. It's iron sharpens iron. We build one another up, and we support one another, encourage one another, and hold one another accountable. And I'm convinced that if the leadership starts like that, Chick-fil-A is like this, Southwest Airlines is like this, there's a lot of companies, even big companies, and they might not be able to do it as complete, you know, with that number of people as you can in a small business, but it's very, very powerful.
Well, but even to get to, you know, this point, there's a lot of humps that we have to get over, and, yeah, you know, times where we didn't do a good job, you know, of coaching or creating community. Mm-hmm. Is there a time when that happened to you that you can remember that you can share?
Absolutely. Still happens. It still happens. Not as frequently, but I was a terrible leader. I saw this vision, and my definition of leadership is leadership is effectively communicating the vision, all right? So I had this vision of a turnkey business, and everything is systematized, just like McDonald's. This is how you do it. This is the button that you push next. You never deviate from that, because if you do, the fries aren't going to be exactly right. You know, it was just that kind of thing. But what I didn't realize is that my strong, outgoing, task-oriented, demanding, direct, defiant personality was really turning everybody off. And one day, my bookkeeper, I would come in the office and start barking out orders. Why isn't this done? Why isn't that done? And I wasn't unhappy. It probably seemed that way to everybody else, but that's just, you know, we just get stuff done. And she took me aside and she said, Howard, I don't know if you realize this or not, but there are people, actual human beings present in this office. You might smile and say good morning. That might go a long way. And I thought, interesting. So I started learning about leadership. And you can have all the systems you want, but if people aren't willing to follow you, and so that's the more difficult part, and that's really what the power of community is all about, is you can have all the vision that you want, you can have all the goals that you want, you can have all the tracking that you want and the systems that you want, but leadership is influence. Influence is you gain influence by adding value to people. You can have everything you want in life, in business, if you just help enough other people get what it is that they want. Leadership is effectively communicating the vision. Effective communication means that I am sharing the vision with you. You're buying into me. You're buying into the vision. You're buying into the concept, or you're giving me enough feedback that we're creating this vision together and adjusting the course together. And I cannot think of a more powerful way to communicate than community. I mean, we're literally communicating in unity where we belong together, and people can get so much meaning from their work, and their work and their relationships at work can add so much value to their life. It's amazing.
Well, I mean, I'm glad that you actually have learned those lessons and that you actually are sharing them with others. The Fast Leader Legion hopes that you continue to do that, and we wish you the very best. Now, before we move on, let's get a quick word from our sponsor. An Even Better Place to Work is an easy-to-use solution that improves the empathy and emotional intelligence skills in everyone. It provides a continuous diagnostic on employee engagement and provides integrated activities that will improve the leadership and collaboration skills in everyone. This award-winning solution is guaranteed to create motivated, productive, and higher-performing employees that have great working relationships with their colleagues and your customers. To learn more about An Even Better Place to Work, visit beyondmorale.com/better. All right, here we go, Fast Leader Legion. It's time for the Hump Day Hoedown. Okay, Howard, the Hump Day Hoedown is the part of our show where you give us good insights fast. So I'm going to ask you several questions, and your job is to give us robust yet rapid responses that are going to help us move onward and upward faster. Howard Partridge, are you ready to hoedown?
Yeah, but I'm from Alabama. Do I have to talk as fast as you're talking right now? I did move up to Houston, so that helped a little bit. And I married my Italian wife from New Jersey, so maybe I can make this happen.
Sounds good. What do you think is holding you back from being an even better leader today?
I would have to say just intentionally making time for my team. I'm so busy. I'm traveling. I'm doing this. I'm writing. I'm having meetings and different things like that, just to be with my leadership team more.
What is the best leadership advice you have ever received?
Probably what I shared earlier, that you can have everything in life you want if you just help enough other people get what it is that they want.
What is one of your secrets that you believe contributes to your success?
Again, it's all about relationships. All of business and all of life is about relationships. When I see a person, even if it's a flight attendant, I try to add value to them, because you never know what conversation you're going to have with someone that helps you to helps you in some way. And so I would say that without a doubt, it's just valuing people, recognizing people, appreciating people, and building relationships.
What do you feel is one of your best tools that helps you lead in business or life?
I would say my reputation is a tool. My character, integrity, how I live my life, I think is my best tool. And I think that that's the best tool that anybody could have. Obviously books, obviously seminars, obviously podcasts like this.
What would be one book that you'd recommend to our listeners? And it could be from any genre. And of course, we're going to put a link to The Power of Community, How Phenomenal Leaders Inspire Their Teams, Wow Their Customers, and Make Bigger Profits on your show notes page as well.
Well, I suppose that would depend on where the audiences, you know, audience members coming from and what season of life they're in, but you can't go wrong with See You at the Top or How to Win Friends and Influence People. Top Performance is Mr. Ziegler's leadership book. We're about to rewrite that. And so that would be a good start for leaders.
Okay, Fast Leader Legion, you can find links to that and other bonus information from today's show by going to fastleader.net/Howard Partridge. Okay, Howard, this is my last Hump Day Hoedown question. Imagine you were given the opportunity to go back to the age of 25. You have been given the opportunity to take the knowledge and skills that you have now back with you. But you can't take everything back. You can only choose one. So what skill or piece of knowledge would you take back with you, and why?
Oh, very simple. Every single person I met, I would add value to them, and I would stay in touch with them. I would have a system of staying in touch and adding value to them and staying connected.
Howard, it was an honor to spend time with you today. Can you please share with the Fast Leader Legion how they can connect with you?
HowardPartridge.com, P-A-R-T-R-I-D-G-E, HowardPartridge.com, just like the bird, or if it's Christmas time, partridge in a pear tree.
Howard Partridge, thank you for sharing your knowledge and wisdom. The Fast Leader Legion honors you and thanks you for helping us get over the hump. Thank you for joining me on the Fast Leader Show today. For recaps, links from every show, special offers, and access to download and subscribe, if you haven't already, head on over to fastleader.net so we can help you move onward and upward faster.